More than 100 young people rallied in front of Trevor Brown High School in Phoenix this week. They were protesting Maricopa County Sheriff Joe Arpaio's immigration policies. Police arrested six of the demonstrators. Here to talk about the protest is Antonio Bustamante, civil rights attorney and a member of the board of directors for Los Abogados. He is also the recipient of the inaugural Los Abogados Lifetime Achievement Award. Antonio, welcome to Horizonte. We've had you here before to talk about a lot of these kinds of issues, the same ones that were at the root of the demonstration earlier this week. I know you weren't directly involved, and neither was Los Abogados, but give us your observations as to what was going on.
Well, what was going on was the frustration of our young people here in our community over what they see as inexplicable, abject injustice by grown-ups who are acting badly. They do not understand the attack on the Latino community, and really their parents and themselves that we've witnessed in the last 3 to 5 years here in Maricopa County. It's irrational. They do not understand why many of them are considered to be outcasts of society simply for having been brought here as infants at a tender age, and who are in every way Americans, except for the fact they were not born here, and being treated as though they should now be forced to leave, or being treated as though they cannot now go on to university careers because those doors are closed to them in terms of financial aid and grants and funding. They don't understand that. It's illogical. It is impossible under criminal law, under the laws of the state of Arizona and the other states to commit even a misdemeanor, yet they are being punished and not being allowed to take their proper place in this society. And they do have a proper place in the society after having been educated here and make contributions to the society through education. We're talking about the cream of the crop, our most precious people, our youth, our future.
And so their focus is education and the denial of educational opportunities, at least at the higher ed level. And that's where the DREAM Act comes in, because that's a pathway for them to obtain those educational benefits and ultimately legal status. So does that mean then that their anger is misdirected, because they're not really the focus of the raids that Sheriff Arpaio has initiated? And it was pretty clear that the DREAM Act is the legislation they're pushing, and that's not something that Arpaio controls.
It is not, but the reaction, I believe, is to the irrational nature of the vitriol against the Latino community. It's expressed by refusal at a national level to pass a DREAM Act. What they did is a manifestation of their anger at the top law enforcement officer of the county, singling out their community, their parents, their loved ones, their relatives, their friends, for raids that separate families and do nothing more but cause misery against a whole swath of people here in our community who are doing nothing more but working hard to make a living, help the economic engine of our state go round and round, and be contributing members of this society. The idea that they are not stakeholders, that they do not have their place in our society, is fallacious. These students know that. They know their parents, that they themselves are very good people, intend to continue to be good people and contributing members of society, and the attacks upon them and their loved ones are irrational, and they make no sense. They had enough, and they protested.
And six of them, as I understand, chose to be arrested, and apparently their status is they're undocumented. They're running a risk of deportation.
They are running a risk of deportation. They're valiant. They're courageous. And one would think that if you had talked to someone wiser and older, maybe you would not have done that. I'm hoping, however, that they will not be kept in deportation proceedings under the president's new standards for putting people or keeping people in deportation proceedings unless they have criminal records or pose a danger to society. Under the new policies on how to enforce the immigration laws, I'm hopeful that the students will fall into that category and not be placed in deportation, and will ultimately, once the DREAM Act passes, because I believe it will one day, that these young kids or these young people will, because they're not kids in my mind, they're brave and young and brilliant, But I hope they will be allowed to take their proper place in our society because of things like a Dream Act.
Now, Antonio, you're one of those wiser older people, one, though, who has been very actively involved in these kinds of issues, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. But the reason why you're being honored this weekend by Los Abogados, the Hispanic Bar Association, is because of your lifetime of involvement in these areas. And it's something that started when you were in college, as I understand.
Well, yes. I mean, we were all members of MECHA, the Latino Law Students Association, on every campus in the Southwest, at least. And in law school,
Even before that, though, as I understand, you walked with Cesar Chavez.
Well, yeah, I was on his road staff. I had a great honor, and I don't know how that. I was so fortunate to have that happen in my life. But I was on his road staff. I was one of seven young men whose job it was to move him around everywhere he went, and take care of logistics, take care of him, take care of big events, provide security. It was an incredible learning experience, not because of the things we did, but because of the fact we were exposed to him on a constant basis, and that is a privilege I thank my lucky stars and the Almighty for. It was an amazing education.
And then, speaking of education, you graduated from Stanford University, and then you went to Antioch Law School because they had the opportunity, or provided the opportunity, for you to be involved almost from the day one in serving clients.
Well, yes, Antioch Law School, when I went to law school, was the nation's only clinical law school. And from the second semester of one's first year in a three-year program, you were representing clients with under the supervision of attorney professors. Plus, you had to take all the normal classes and put up with all that. And most of us felt put out by having to take all those classes and learn contracts and securities law and commercial paper and all the other things, because we wanted to be back in the clinic fighting for our clients and representing them. That's why we went. Of course, we had to really learn the law too. So we had to do the book learning, but the great thing about that law school was that we got to put things into practice so that by the time we graduated, we knew where the courthouse was and we knew how to draft a complaint to file a lawsuit, and that was of great benefit.
And indeed, one of the highlights of your career that people mention a lot is your involvement in the Hannigan Brothers case. And people assume you were a lawyer in that case, but actually you started your involvement there as a law student. First, tell us about the Hannigan Brothers case itself, and then what your role was.
Well, the Hannigan Brothers were from Douglas, Arizona, and they tortured some farm workers that came across their property. This was August of 1976. It led to an international outrage by the Mexican government and many others. And the Hannigans were prosecuted in Bisbee in Cochise County Superior Court. They were acquitted. Many people, including myself, many of us believed that was an unjust verdict. And we believed it was based on the anti-Mexican sentiment in Cochise County at the time, and that still exists to this day in many parts of Cochise County, and indeed the whole state of Arizona. Not everywhere, but it exists, and it's unfortunate. Our role as law students in Washington, D.C. was that because we had access to places of great influence, the House of Representatives, the Senate, the National Council of Churches, AFL-CIO, so many national and international organizations, that we were able to organize and bring pressure to bear on the federal government to prosecute the Hannigans, not for violating state laws, because they had been acquitted of that, but for violating federal law. And we spent a lot of time doing political work and legal work, and ultimately were able to convince the Justice Department, the federal Justice Department, to pursue indictments. They received indictments. After everything was said and done, there were two federal trials. To show how difficult it is, however, in a race-charged kind of environment to get a conviction, one of the brothers was finally convicted and the other was never convicted.
Now, after you started practicing law, you were involved in a number of other celebrated cases. Time permits us only to discuss a few aspects of that. One was a case involving militia back in the 80s.
Well, yeah, in 1986, a group called Civilian Material Assistance decided to be an operation to stop immigration, undocumented immigration, and they would hold up people at gunpoint, men, women, children, and then hold them there after doing unsavory things to them, hold them for Border Patrol. And then Border Patrol would take them out of the country. We were furious about that because felonies were being committed by holding up people at gunpoint, especially against women and children. We finally got some of the members of that organization prosecuted under federal law as well, but those activities came to a screeching halt once we were able to convince the federal government to stop it.
And then fast forwarding to the present time, and again, there's a lot more to talk about, but you've been involved in the immigration issues and debates representing people who've been arrested for protesting, for example, SB 1070.
Well, there were many people arrested during the demonstrations against SB 1070. On the day that law was supposed to take effect, and parts of it did take effect, because as we remember, much of it was enjoined by the federal court, but the parts that did take effect caused huge demonstrations. There were many people arrested here in Phoenix for those demonstrations. I think 94 is the number that were arrested. Of all those cases, only six people were ever convicted of a crime, and they were all misdemeanors. Everyone else was acquitted or had their cases thrown out of court.
Antonio, last question. A lot has happened since SB 1070 was enacted, those protests that you mentioned occurred. How do you see things? And in your mind, where do we stand today?
Well, I'd like to look at it in an optimistic way. I think that we are that as a state, as a community, the whole community, not just Latino community. I think Arizonans started to learn that it's not okay to dislike Hispanics. It's not okay just because they're Hispanics. It's not okay to have ill will toward the undocumented just because they do not have papers. I think people are starting to understand finally the role the undocumented play in their contribution to our state and to all of society, and that ugliness people felt now that they had a chance through SB 1070 to think they were doing the right thing by giving expression to their ill sentiments toward the Latino community, because of the national reaction, or because they themselves, people who felt badly against our communities, saw that they started to feel badly about it. I think the situation has dramatically improved. We see that in the state legislature this year. There are almost no immigration bills of the nature that we've seen in the past that really harmed the community. SB 1070 was only one. It was going to be the most comprehensive, but there are many others. We see much less of that now, and we saw much less of it last year when the state legislature, because of the initiative of the business leadership of the state, decided not to pass a whole bunch of immigration bills that would have been detrimental to our community, not the least of which would have been the one that would have tried to establish that a person born in the United States to undocumented parents would not be a U.S. citizen.
Antonio, congratulations on your award, well deserved.
Thank
you for joining us on Horizonte to talk about your career and about the latest involvement of students.
Well, thanks. It's been a pleasure.
Here.
Thank you.